Good morning, everybody. People are still joining. We'll start in a bit. See, nobody misses anything. If you join, feel free to keep your webcam on or switch it on. It's nice for me to see some faces and not only blank screens. Of course, if you're not able or capable or decent enough to switch on your camera, please hold it off. It's nice to see some faces and your reactions. If you think I am telling you stuff that you don't agree with, just show it, shout it. The chat is open in Slack and in WebEx, so if you have questions, remarks, want to dive deeper in some details, just put it in the message so I can respond to it. If I'm not able or capable at that moment in time to answer questions, we can maybe do it in the end or reach out to each other later. I think most people are in, and then I say shame on them if they are too late. Let's start. Welcome to my session about postponing architectural choices and start developing first with Dapper, which is quite a little bit longer than just the title Dapper 101 or your first steps with Dapper. So I probably have some additional meaning to it. First, about myself, with a nice pre-corona picture, so no haircuts recently. I'm Michael Hompes. I'm an IT architect at InfoSport in the Netherlands. For your convenience, I've put up my Twitter and my GitHub link. If you want to reach out later, please feel free. For your convenience, I try to make QR codes so you can just snap them with your camera and don't have to type all those long URLs in. So yeah, this session is about Dapper. So Dapper is great. Why would I otherwise have a talk on it? For those who don't know Dapper is something introduced by Microsoft in 2019, in the end of the year. It's new. So therefore, we developers think it's cool because everything that's new is always more awesome than the code we already know and the frameworks we already use. I could do my session about that, so introduction to Dapper. But I thought, okay, why would I use Dapper? Which problem does it solve? So that's where the architectural decisions part of my talk come in. So let's first look at what does it promise and why would it be of any benefit to us? Let's say you start a new project. You want to build a new product or have some internal development. You just do not start building out of the blue. You probably have some choices to make, and then you have to think about those choices. Most of the time, we do that fairly implicitly, not be very conscious about it, but you are doing it. And those choices are influenced by other factors. So if you look at making those choices, what input do we have? Well, first of all, you have your customer. This might be a customer that your company create software for. It might be an internal customer. It might be yourself, building your own project. You're basically your own customer. Might also be, as an organization, you have a customer in mind for the future, but not already really somebody who has bought your software. But customers have expectations. So they probably want something out of your product. The business value, the added value for them. So that's the first part of input you might base your choices on. Then you have your organization, and I know we're now presenting in London, of course, so I should have written this with an S. But your organization, where you're part of, that might also influence your choices. But most of the time, an organization will make might pose constraints on you. your choices. So for example, your organization might say, we only use the Microsoft stack, or we want to build all our software on top of SharePoint, or we only do Linux. Those kinds of constraints, licenses, environment, are constraining you in your choices you can make. And of course, if you're not building on your own, but even on your own, this applies, you have a team with experiences and assumptions. So experience might be, I have been building applications for 20 years in .NET, therefore I will be developing the next project also in .NET. Or your team has at the start of project, we are going to take all the newest technology available because this is the only moment in time we can do some new development in our organization. These kinds of things happen, and people might have assumptions, and those assumptions and experiences might also influence the choices you make. So we have not written a single line of code, and we already have expectations, constraints, and assumptions we have to deal with. And if we just start developing now, we might get into trouble later. So what we want to develop, we can break that down in complexity. And maybe for some people, this is a familiar model, but you can break down complexity in two parts, essential complexity and accidental complexity. If we look at a product we want to build, the business value we want to add for our customer or ourselves, that business value is pretty much essential complexity. All code we need to write, all technology we need to include to create the business value is essential. And another part is maybe we need some state. We need to store things for later use or for whatever reason. And as a developer, you might already be starting in your mind, oh, state, that means I need a database. And to access the database, I need a relational mapper to create clean code. And then I should put in Entity Framework or Hibernate or whatever library to do that. So you're already making a lot of choices, or in your mind, or even maybe in your code, about how you want to deal with the state. And another part might be, for a lot of reasons, we want to deliver this product as microservices. That can be very essential complexity because of scalability or availability or other reasons. Having microservices as a design might be essential complexity. So does not mean that every technology immediately is accidental complexity. We accept some complexity that comes around with choosing a microservices architecture. And when we are starting to think about microservices, often we need some kind of orchestration to have that availability and scalability around. So that orchestration comes as additional accidental complexity, because now we are thinking, oh, maybe we should do this in Kubernetes, or, well, there are some other orchestrators around, but not much used. Basically, Kubernetes is at this moment in time the de facto standard. And then you have to think about, okay, but how are you going to deploy those services into that orchestration framework? So maybe you're going to look at Helm. Maybe you're going to look at other technologies to deploy your services. You need to configure them. And now I need to know how I'm going to configure those services. Those services need to talk with each other. So maybe I have to think about connectivity. Am I going to put in web services, gRPC? I have to make choices. And if I have those connections, they might fail. So maybe I need a retry mechanism. So I'm starting to think about reliability. Or maybe I don't want those direct connections. Maybe I should go for more like a service bus. So maybe the PubSub pattern might be sufficient, or worse, do both at the same time. And now I need to know, is everything running okay? So I might switch some, put some observability in my platform. Maybe add some Zipkin, or maybe we have read about that new Istio, and maybe a service mesh might add all those, a couple of those additional complexity topics and combine those in a mesh. So we have added a lot of complexity, and then we are still not running anywhere. So maybe we have to think about where we are going to deploy. Cloud is basically everywhere these days. If you have a server under your desk, that's an on-premises cloud. And if you use one of the public clouds like Amazon or Azure or Alibaba, you might think about a public cloud where you want to deploy. So the rate of additional complexity, often added without thinking about it, but the team that is going to develop and maintain this has to know about a lot of these topics to be productive, to have a working application in the cloud. And this was only the designing phase, because then, of course, reality happens. There are, of course, changes. Maybe new functionality. And the customer sees your first demo and thinks, oh, if this is possible, maybe another thing is possible, or maybe they have a change of insight. That never happens, of course, with your customers. We can have changes in non-functional requirements. Maybe the performance is not what they thought that the application would provide, or the skill is changing. More customers are signing up than expected. So maybe we now need to be able to cope with millions of requests, and we only designed for thousands of requests. It might also be that you were targeting a couple of customers, but you're building awesome software. So more and more customers want to use your software. But then, of course, not every customer might want to have it in the same way configured or in the same way deployed. What if you have that golden goose, that customer that is the customer you want, but you have built everything on Azure using Azure Service Bus, and that customer says, I want to buy your product, but you need to deploy it on-premise in our data center using Kafka. Can you handle those changes? Are you able to adopt your application? And I think even if you have done layering and do a lot of the things right we know of these days, then still you have those dependencies. Can your object be mapped to a SQL database and a Redis NoSQL cache at the same time? Or are you having to map your objects and have multiple versions of your objects? So how much code do you need to add or rewrite to be able to cope with these kinds of changes? So this is not every project, I hope, for you, but these are things that happen in practice. And a couple of years ago, I came across this quote by Ruth Milan and Dana Breedemeyer: an architect should make as few decisions as possible, deferring the rest until later in the life cycle. And basically, this is what I want to look into. Can Tepper help us with this? Is it possible to defer decisions to a later moment in time when we know more, so we don't make the choices too early on? Can we postpone these choices? And if we can defer decisions, maybe we can also look, can we reduce all those accidental complexities topics I just mentioned? Because that would make our life much easier. So I showed you the logo of Tepper before. So who's the person with the top hat? Let's meet the person of mystery. Tepper stands for Distributed Application Runtime. So it's not called a framework on purpose, it's a runtime. And if you go to the Tepper site, they say an event-driven portable runtime for building microservices on cloud and edge. An edge is these days just the term they write because everybody has trouble to write on premises correctly. So they call it edge these days. But it means basically run it everywhere. So when the team behind Dapper started, they had some goals. They wanted to provide building blocks, and not just normal building blocks, but even the building blocks are following all the best practices around those topics and building blocks. It should be able to work with any language or framework. It should be consistent, portable, and contain open APIs. It should adapt standards, so it should be not completely reinventing the world. It should be extendable and pluggable. And like I already mentioned, it should be platform agnostic. So it should be able to run in Azure, should be able to run on-premise, should be able to run in Alibaba Cloud. And of course, like many projects these days, and luckily Microsoft jumped on the bandwagon, community-driven and vendor-neutral. So even though Microsoft started this project, it's run by the community, it's on GitHub. There are monthly meetings you can join, and you can just as easy use it with AWS components, Google Cloud components, or Azure components. So I think quite some goals to go into. Like I already said, building apps using any language, any framework. So we have those building blocks. The building blocks are listed here, serve to service invocation, state management, publish and subscribe, resource bindings and triggers, actors, distributed tracing, secrets, and it should be extendable. A couple of these building blocks I will go to into depth in this session. A couple I will leave out because there's too much to cover, and I don't think every building block will be as interesting to get our first bearings with Dapper. Those building blocks are all connected using an HTTP API or a gRPC API. So these are those standards. And of course, about any framework or programming language is capable to do any form of HTTP. So this lowers the bar of using Dapper as a runtime. So you can use it from Go, you can use it from C Sharp, you can use it from Java, you can use it from anywhere where you can basically build an HTTP connection. And on the other hand, you're able to deploy your applications using any cloud, Kubernetes on-premise. You can run it without Kubernetes, just on your desktop. That's the promise and the thought about behind Dapper. How do they do that? That's done with a sidecar architecture. Maybe you know sidecars as terminology from Kubernetes, but even without Kubernetes, it's possible to use sidecar architectures. Basically, I have here two services, A and B. Dapper will provide a sidecar for every service. That's the API. The service is communicating to the Dapper sidecar using that API. And those sidecars can communicate with each other. And this can be done securely using MTLS. Those sidecars are capable of connecting for example, loading and save state to state stores, or for example, publish and subscribe to messaging buses. And here again, a lot of different choices in vendors. It's not Microsoft only, it's not limited, it's open and everybody can extend on it. And also it's capable of scanning for events. Those are the resource bindings. So for example, I can consume from Kafka or I can produce to, for example, SendGrid. That API is very standardized inside Dapper, and that makes it very consistent. Currently, basically, we have some endpoints. Every building block has one endpoint. Of course, every subscribe has it too. And observability doesn't have an endpoint. That's open tracing, automatically embedded in everything. So let's look at a very simple example of how does service invocation work. I have a front-end web app, for example, and a card service. Both services get my sidecar. I do a post against invoke. So that means I want to communicate with another service. Card means this is the service I want to communicate with. And in case of invocation, we have a method. In this case, checkout, I want to invoke on the card service. As frontend, I don't know where card is running, if it's in which language it's working. I just post a JSON payload to that endpoint and Dapper will handle the communication. The sidecar will find the sidecar that's connected to the card service. And in this case, the card service is running on port 8000 on IP address, which is not reachable from the outside. And it will do a post against a checkout method. Card service doesn't know who is invoking. It might be external, it might be internal, it might be another service, might be a trigger. It just responds, and Dapper will make sure the response comes back. A second building block, state management. If I have an app and I want to post to the state endpoint and I have a store name, I can post a collection of objects, key value pairs. The Dapper endpoint will know which application is posting it, so it will make sure the keys are namespaced and the value will be stored. If the app now says get from this store name planet, Dapper sidecar will know which key that means, pick up the payload and return it to the application. If the state store is Redis or Cosmos DB, again, the application doesn't know, only the sidecar will know by the configuration. So enough talk, let's show some working code. First, I will show you, not sure why my screen is leaking, a simple application, Hello World. This is an app node application. It uses Express. It has some configuration. In this case, we will be using the default port, 3500. We will be communicating with the state, and the state store is called state store. Not very original. We have two endpoints here. We have post slash new order. So basically we are going to host a endpoint new order, which will accept a post. It will parse the body. It will create a state object and it will post that against the state URL we have defined above. So this is a node application posting against the endpoint of the Dapper sidecar instance. On the other hand, we declare that there's a get endpoint order, which will also communicate with the state endpoint and will request the key named order. So here we store it with the key order and here we request it with the key order. And basically we will return it to whoever is requesting this. So we need to run this application. For this, we use the Dapper command. If it's too small for anybody, just say it. I will increase the font size if needed. Run this application on port 3000 and just saying node app.js. So basically, this is just a node application. Well, we get some information. The application is now running. And if we now are checking, we will invoke the sidecar here and we will say from node up, I want to execute the order method, which will return whatever is at this moment in our state. Well, nothing. Now we will post this data against the new order endpoint. We'll get back an OK, and if we now get the order again, we see the data is returned. We can also look inside Redis, and we see that there is now a node app. So this is the namespace, the application that has stored the order key, and we can find the contents of the app. We are now using Redis, but in the app itself, there's no Redis library. We don't have any dependencies. We don't have a whole NPM tree of packages needed to be able to communicate with Redis. We still only have Express and some additional code to be able to work with JSON. And that's it. Second application I have here is a Python application, same configuration, or in this case, the configuration of not a state store, but where is the other app I want to invoke. Which is what I did with the HTTP example is now written in Python. It will do an enumeration. It will build an object, and it will post against the sidecar a message which will is created here. And then wait a second. So if we go to the shell and run this application, doesn't output anything, but if we now switch back to the node application, we see our old 42, and we now see the Python application posting data against this application. These two applications don't know they exist. They are just communicating with their Dapper endpoint. But something is working on the background. And if we now look in Redis again, we see the order ID is now 8 and the record has been updated 9 times. Going back to the presentation. So first I've shown as a user, I could communicate with the Dapper sidecar. The sidecar was executing node code. The node code says store something in state. And then the Dapper sidecar was storing that state in Redis. Second example I shown was that that was not an external user doing this, but the Python code was communicating with its sidecar, and that sidecar was communicating with the other sidecar, netting the same result as we showed before. So there are a couple of state stores currently supported. Cassandra, Couchbase, HashiCorp Console, but also Postgres or SQL Server. Some are even transactional aware. So basically you can do multiple actions at the same time, and it's an all or nothing. But there are quite some state stores you already can use. But of course, we are running it locally. Maybe we want to run it with pods and having some deployment with failover functionality or more reliability. So we might choose to run Dapper inside Kubernetes. When you initialize Dapper in Kubernetes, it will create 4 pods. The actor placement for the actor model, the sidecar injector, the sentry. Sentry is making sure all the communication is encrypted between pods and certificates are replaced regularly, and the operator. And the operator is doing all component management with whatever component we have configured we want to use. So I will be deploying my container with application, and the sidecar injector will notice this and will make sure also a Dapper sidecar is injected at the same time. And that sidecar will then be able to communicate with all the components and use them and do everything that's necessary. So let's look at an example of that. For this, I use a project called the Distributed Calculator, which is a platform with 5 applications. It has a C#.NET application, and it does all the subtractions. So this is an ASP.NET MVC application. It has a controller, and every time somebody posts against subtract, it will operate, do an operation, and it will subtract 2 numbers. This is the .NET application. We'll have a Go application. That Go application will be doing, the additions. So that will be adding 2 numbers. And here again, you don't see any, basically no deprecate, but also no other dependencies, only HTTP endpoint. We have a node application doing the divisions. Well, of course, this looks a lot like the way we built the first example. We have a Phyton application, which does the multiplications. And just to show when we are going to deploy, we have a YAML file. And basically, by adding these 4 annotations, are saying this is a Dapper application with this name. It will be running on port 5000. We can apply additional configuration and it's enabled. This is enough information for the sidecar injector to do its work. So we are going to deploy. We're going to apply everything. And of course, we are looking at the pods. And here you see ready 0 of 2, because it's not only creating the container and the application itself, it's also adding that sidecar to it. So I think everything is running now, which means we should have a front end. Yes. So for example, I do 7 times 7 is 94. -6 +9, some division, addition, multiplication, more division. I've done some stuff. Well, the calculator seems to work. This is basically just a React app. You only a UI shield. And if we now look inside Docker, we see our Docker containers. We can also see all those sidecars. So for example, I have here the multiply application. I also have a Dapper-D multiply application. So those are the sidecars. If I now look at the logs of my application, that was the front end, all the different applications, I can see, okay, this application was adding numbers. This application was subtracting numbers. This application was dividing numbers. So every application is only providing the business value it's intended for. And it doesn't know anything about that something is stored, which serves are available. It's just doing its job. Microservices, as we always say, they are intended. WebEx is popping something up. So let's remove this and then go back to the slides. What you have seen here is that as a user, I've deployed all my containers, and then the operator makes sure everything is available and all the sidecars are available. And I have all those different applications running and communicating with the front end, without any other dependency inside my applications. So next step is to look at some of the input bindings, and maybe people of know Azure Functions. When I saw this, that was my first association. An input binding means you can pick basically any input, which of course has a input binding developed for Dapper, like Kafka, like Event Hubs, but also, for example, Twitter, and you describe, I want to listen to it. The sidecar will be doing the listening, and every time a event occurs, for example, a Twitter event message has been posted that is meeting the demands of your configuration, and the Dapper sidecar will call a trigger on your application. So basically, you only have to provide an endpoint to listen to that trigger. For the output bindings, that's more like, I have an event, I want to reach out to the outside world. So every time that event occurs, I will call my binding, for example, in this case, my database, and I will post some data, and Dapper will use that configured endpoint for that with that name to store that data in or to pass the data along. And for data store, that might be Redis cache again, or Kafka, or Twilio, whatever you want to need or need. There are a lot of bindings these days. So we have some Azure-specific bindings, but you see there are some bindings that are only output or only input or both. We have AWS, we have Google Cloud Platform, and we have some generics. For example, Postmark, that's a binding I've written myself. If you want to send an email using Postmark, you can use that in your application, or you can configure that in your application. And also talked about the publish and subscribe pattern. Here we can also use Dapper. This should be familiar if you know the PubSub pattern, but as a service, I say I want to publish something on a topic. So basically I call the endpoint, the publish endpoint, and then the configured service bus will make sure that it's available on the topic, and then the other sidecars that have subscribed to that topic will get make sure that then the application will get a post with whatever event has been posted on that topic. So here we can disconnect. And where service invocation is 101, PubSub allows us for publishing one, listening on multiple services. So that's very valuable as well. Until now, I've shown you raw HTTP endpoints. So basically running your own HTTP endpoint controller and posting against that HTTP endpoint. Of course, as developers, we also want to be lazy and not do all the handling of HTTP and contracts ourselves. So also Dapper has provided us native SDKs for many languages. So these can help. But of course, if you have a language that's not supported, you can always use just the plain HTTP or gRPC. So all these last topics, PubSub, SDKs, and triggers, I want to use or are used in the next demo so we can see them nicely combined. For this, I will be using the Dapper traffic control example, which is created by my colleague Edwin van Wijk. I've shared the link to his to this repository on the slide. And this example is a way of building a system where we have a highway with an entry and an exit camera. Not sure if every country knows these systems, but in the Netherlands, we like to invent these kinds of systems, and we apply them on our highways where we are measuring how long or how fast a car has traveled between two points. And if this is over the legal limit, you get a ticket. And of course, we don't want to write them manually, so we have automated that all the way until you get something in your mail. And this is a system we will be building using Dapper. Or while building, I will show you because we don't have time to go from scratch. So first, looking at the code. To start, one of the applications, I have multiple, but I just opened, in this case, the simulation application. Here you see we have a package reference to the Dapper client. This is the only reference to any package. So you, we don't have any ORM mappers. We don't have SQL libraries. We only have the Dapper client in this application. In this case, this is the simulation who is going to simulate cars driving on three lanes and having an entry and exit time. And here we can see some configuration, and then we have the Dapper client. And after we have built the Dapper client, we can, for example, publish event to a topic, to a PubSub. So our configuration is called PubSub. The topic is called Traffic Control Entry Cam, and now we pass on the payload. And also for the configuration PubSub, we post an exit cam topic and a payload. And this is how we use the SDK. And this limits, of course, the amount of code you have to write to do basic HTTP or gRPC. So it's more convenient for the user. Everything is async, so it can match up with your code or patterns you apply in your application. So this is the simulation software. Here we see that PubSub configuration. So I have a PubSub YAML file. We describe a Dapper component with the name PubSub. In this case, we use Redis as a store, and we use Redis on localhost without a password. So this is how the PubSub is now configured for this application. If we look at one of the other services, we, in this case, we have a web application using ASP.NET MVC. So in the startup, we just say add Dapper to our controllers. So this does a lot of magic injection, making Dapper available using dependency injection, but also making sure a lot of additional fancy stuff is available for us in our controllers. So where we have an API controller, which might already have been available using our regular HTTP endpoint, in this case, in ASP.NET MVC, we now can also say, besides having HTTP post on this, subscribe on PubSub to this topic. So basically, this does the whole registration and makes sure that the sidecar knows if you see a message on this endpoint, on this topic, make sure you call this endpoint. And because we have dependency injection, we get a Dapper client instance injected into this method. In this case, we also use the secrets capabilities of Dapper to get some API key. Here we call with invoke another service using a certain endpoint. And here we see that we do a save state. So basically we're storing an object inside the Dapper store. In this case, the Dapper store name is state store. So like I've shown you, we have a PubSub YAML. We have also a state store YAML, which at this moment also uses Redis as a state store. Same instance as we use for our PubSub. And we, for example, if there is a speeding violation, we will also have some logging. So if we combine all these things together, let's see how that's looking. First, I will start the government service. So that's running now. I will start the traffic control service. It's also running. And now I will start the simulation. So after the simulation has started, it will mimic the behavior of three cameras. We see some number plates going along, in this case, three on lane three. So it's a busy lane. And we also see some exits. So if we now, very annoying that my WebEx pop-up is constantly going over my tabs. We see that the other applications get some data, so we'll stop the simulation. So here we see entries and we see also speeding violations. And some are not heavy enough. And some are heavy enough that there will be a fine of 130 euros. So basically, these are the different services working together. If we now look at our Redis cache, and for some sad reason, I need to use a different instance of code for this, we'll see that there are here the topics. So basically, these are the topics as a PubSub system. And we have all the vehicle data about entry and exit stored in our local store. So this application is capable of running without a heavy Redis cache. This is just a very simple local Redis instance. But maybe we want a little bit more. Maybe we will want to use a different system for storage or PubSub. Let's say for PubSub, we want to use Redis, but not local on our machine. So other systems might also be able to use it. So for this, I have deployed Redis cache in Azure, which is basically just a Redis store, but then publicly available and managed by Microsoft for me. And I provide, of course, a password, which I won't show you at the moment. And for the state store, I say, okay, let's not use Redis as a state store. I want to use Cosmos DB. So we comment the configuration for Cosmos or for Redis and uncomment the configuration for Cosmos DB. So we use the Dapper Cosmos named instance. We have a Dapper database and a vehicles collection. So I didn't change anything in my application. I've only changed two configuration files. And that now will make a difference between you running everything in Redis locally to running everything in Azure in this case, where I use Redis for PubSub and I use Cosmos DB for storage. So now I have to restart my application because then it will pick up the new configuration. I will clear the local storage. And already we see that topics are generated because the clients have subscribed to these three topics. So already in Azure, we have now Redis being used. And looking at our Cosmos, always nice that after a while it needs to refresh everything. It should currently be empty. Yes, luckily. So if we now start the simulation again, it will not only be using the Redis endpoint. I have to pick the right. So if we now look here in these topics, we see a lot of events. So that's good. And if we now look at Cosmos DB, we see all the objects are stored in Cosmos DB with an entry and an exit time. And I'll stop the simulation to not waste everything. So this is the ease which you can change dependencies. And one example of being extendable. So for example, if I go to this controller, these were the log messages of, hey, we have to send a speeding ticket. But actually no external communication is happening at this moment. So let's say it's very logical to do this using emails, of course. Let's say we want to send an email using postmark with a violation. And because this is async, we will make this method async. We will send the email to the administration and to the treasury at the government, and the subject is more cash incoming. And the body will be that same text as we have logged. This is everything I have to do to now send an email every time a traffic violation has occurred. And also here, I've chosen the name postmark, so this matches my component called postmark. And here I have set the email from and the configuration of my tokens I need for postmark. And this is everything. My code is still limited to my business value. I want to send an email if this occurs. Nothing about postmark, no new APIs, SDKs, I have to maintain inside my application. So what I've shown you was the simulation using PubSub and then the sidecars interacting with the different services. And also in first example, one of the sidecars using Redis as a state store. So there are more building blocks. We have seen service to service invocation, state management, publish and subscribe, the resource bindings. I didn't go into actors distributing tracing and secrets. Actors, if you're familiar with the actor model, allows you to store data. Dapper will make sure to distribute your actors over pods. Distributed tracing using the open census standard. So all the tracing is done and you can use that with Jaeger, Prometheus, Azure Monitor, whatever. Is using the open census standard for monitoring. And secrets, it came along for one of the parts in the demo, but basically you can use secrets in Azure Key Vault, in HashiCorp Vault. You can use Kubernetes secrets these days to store things you don't want in your application code, which are also most of the time deployment specific. So, two after these demos, let's look at the verdict of, is Dapper being able to start as developing without making too much choices about dependencies at the beginning, to be able to focus on essential complexity and remove a lot of the additional complexity? Well, there are some pros. I think we reduced a lot of code, basically only stating business logic. So what do we really want to achieve in the application? And with that, a lot of accidental complexity is removed, and mainly all those dependencies I have to maintain. If I would have had a situation where I had to support AWS for one customer, Azure for another customer, and local deployment for another customer, basically I only have to change my configuration file, because that API doesn't change for that. I don't need to learn all the specific SDKs. Of course, the downside is you also don't have access to all the specifics that are not the common denominator. There's no dependency update hell, because all the dependencies are inside that sidecar. Of course, you have to upgrade the Dapper dependency. That will still remain a dependency, but at least it's no conflicting npm packages or other dependencies that might give you trouble. And I really think you can really start building your solution, even if it's against a local Redis instance, even if you don't know if you're going to store your data in SQL Server, Cosmos DB, or Cassandra. And you really can change or postpone a lot of those choices until deployment time. And like I said, you can vary those dependencies, so they're not part of your application. This really makes it very portable. And you can run it with Kubernetes, you can run it without Kubernetes. Of course, we have cons. Like I said, with abstractions, you always have a lowest common denominator. So that will really limit, of course, if you really need that specific feature of Kafka, then you might need to think about, okay, then I have to implement Kafka in the regular way, but I might still use that for all the other benefits. or you write your own binding for Kafka that can implement that part. If you want to use something that's not available yet, I want to store data in MariaDB or MySQL. Yeah, sorry, there's nobody has built that component yet. So you can do it yourself or wait for the community to catch up. There are some hidden constraints. If you use Cosmos DB as your data store where you put in data that's, let's say, 8 megabytes big, and then you switch to Azure Table Storage. Well, you can't put 8 megabytes in a table storage record. So there might be hidden constraints. Dapper won't fix it for you. You have still will need to look and keep that for yourself. And it's not in production ready yet. It's still in pre-release. We are currently at pre-release 2. I expect pre-release 3 or release candidate 3, well, basically any minute now, but we'll probably in 1 or 2 months be version 1. So we are in the end game of version 1. Normally, this would be the point in the point where I would do some advanced stuff or at least acknowledge them. But luckily, my colleagues Sander and Edwin will be presenting on Friday at Track 7, and they will cover advanced Dapper topics. So they will go into more detail. In the meantime, I saw. Now the chat window is starting to scroll, so I'll have to catch up, scroll up a bit. So is the performance overhead? Yes, there is a performance overhead. Of course, if you have a direct connection with your endpoint, it's always slower to have a middle in the man, man in the middle. there is an impact. Is it noticeable? I haven't noticed it yet in the application I've built, but then again, I'm mainly focusing on the demo application. I don't have production grade applications done already. But yeah, of course, that's a downside of having a layer in between. Is there any explicit support of multiple versions of services? If you mean, can I have multiple state stores at the same time? Can I have multiple pub/sub stores or applications at the same time? Yes, that's possible. That's why you have to put in that name. Of course, at this moment, I use the very generic state store pub/sub, but then you would have more meaningful names to differentiate between the services you want to implement. Saving state is fantastic. Can we also read state using Dapper for a new request? I'm not sure what you mean with that. So maybe you can clarify a little bit on that. If I is Dapper not more or less equivalent to programming with interfaces? Yes. It is an interface. It's a very generic interface that's cross language. So if you want to combine multiple languages in the same, you can't share your C# interface with your Java instance, for example. So yes, it's a form of interfaces. And if you are focusing only on a certain small stack, maybe Dapper doesn't provide any additional benefits, but it's also intended to use in microservices. And in microservices, it's very much harder to share interfaces. It's possible, of course, but combining languages, combining teams is also depending on your skill of your microservice and your organization building that microservice landscape. Is it possible to run Dapper on something like Azure App Service? I think it should be possible. I've not heard of anybody doing it yet. Good question. I don't know. And the last one is available, the extensions for resilience. For state stores, there is some form of resilience. You can say how state has to be stored in a resilient way. So it should have be very consistent. Those are configurations you can do on some of the state stores that's in the documentation. For PubSub, if you get back the okay that it's stored by the Dapper sidecar, you are it is stored in your PubSub system. So your PubSub system has given the okay. So that's at least to make sure that that you are aware of that. I will move to the slide with references so you can share. I will also put all the URLs in the chat after this session. So at least they are available. So if you need to quit now, they're available there. You can also scan the code for the Dapper website. Is there a way a design time runtime of finding what is subscribed to a pub? I guess it's possible using the Dapper sidecar. Basically, the endpoint is available, or the information is available. I have not done it myself, but basically, when a sidecar starts, or the sidecars also use that information of all the subscribers to know if the application is starting it is needing it. I'm not up to par with what exactly is possible there. I think the metadata should be available, but that's a good question. Maybe it's inside the documentation. You have that subscribe and publish endpoint, but maybe it's somewhere hidden inside the Dapper component service. I'm not aware of it at the moment. With that, I think I've at least caught all current questions. So my time has run out. I'll stick here. I'm in Slack later on. If you want to reach out later, I'm on Twitter and on GitHub. Any other questions, just post them. I think after this call, it's best to do that in Slack. But also later on, you can reach out to me personally during the conference. I will be available. If you want to know more about Dapper, of course, try to catch the session on Friday by Sander and Edwin, because they will go into much more advanced topics. And I hope you like the session. And well, maybe we'll meet a later time. Thank you.